Welcome to Study with the Best, the magazine show about CUNY. I'm Valerie Vasquez.
And I'm Zyphus LeBron. Each year, the MacArthur Foundation gives awards to individuals who've shown exceptional creativity and made outstanding contributions in fields such as science, education, and the arts. The MacArthur Fellowships are more commonly known as Genius Awards and come with a cash prize of $500,000. You can't apply for the award, you have to be nominated. And beyond that, the whole selection process is something of a mystery.
On this edition of Study with the Best, we'll visit City College alumnus Stanley Nelson. He's a respected documentary filmmaker and as a recipient of a 2002 MacArthur Fellowship, a genuine genius.
And a Brooklyn College graduate who's been instrumental in the renovation and restoration of some historic New York City parks.
You'll meet high school students who are part of a CUNY project that teaches them about the New York City Council.
And some CUNY Honors College students who've created their own projects based on some eye-opening cultural experiences. So stay tuned. Last fall, documentary filmmaker Stanley Nelson won a prestigious MacArthur Fellowship. The City College graduate was recognized for his body of work, which includes $2 and a Dream, about Madam C.J. Walker. The hair care entrepreneur was the first black woman in this country to become a millionaire. His 1999 documentary, The Black Press, Soldiers Without Swords, was an award winner at the Sundance Film Festival. Nelson's latest film, The Murder of Emmett Till, is about the 15-year-old black boy who was murdered and mutilated by two white men for whistling at a white woman. While Nelson is obviously no stranger to accolades and acclaim, he remains focused on his work. He says it's not about prizes, it's about passion.
I want people to be moved by my films, and also, you know, I've done a lot of historical films, and I think that what's really important is that people understand that history doesn't exist in a bubble, that we're not trying to do films that are just historical, but that have a resonance today. I grew up in an era where African-American people weren't on screen at all, you know, on TV or in film. I mean, you almost never saw an African-American at all. But in the 60s, in the late 60s, you started seeing people in the blaxploitation films. And it kind of opened up my eyes and a lot of people's eyes. I mean, we thought that, now here's black people on the screen, but that we could make films that were a lot more real and that we could do it, you know, a lot better than the films that were being made at that point. So I enrolled in film school. I went to school at the Leonard Davis Center, and it was incredible. It was an incredible experience. Well, I think that one thing that Leonard Davis Center did was that it said to us, you know, get the cameras in your hands. There wasn't a lot of separation between us and the filmmaking process. I mean, it was very much hands-on. Put a camera in your hand, go out and shoot, and then let's talk about what you shot and try to make it better. So it really demystified the whole filmmaking process and made it, in some ways, very accessible for me as a filmmaker. I guess there are three films that to me are really important. One is $2 and a Dream, the story of Madam C.J. Walker, because that was the first film that I made, and that took seven or eight years to make, and it was my first independent film.
In those days, nappy hair was considered a problem by just about everyone, except Madam C.J. Walker. She was born Sarah Breedlove in 1867 to slaves newly freed by the Civil War in this cabin in Delta, Louisiana. Married at 14, widowed with a daughter, Alilia, at 20, she had little other than her dreams. Dreams, she said, of a magic formula that would solve those nappy-headed blues. For Madam C.J. Walker, these nappy heads would become her fortune, although she began with only $2 and a dream.
The Black Press was also very important because that film also took 7 or 8 years to make, and it was a film that there was no story. You know, Madam C.J. Walker was the story of Madam C.J. Walker and her daughter Alelia. The Black Press, there was no story. It was a film that we had to kind of construct. We had to make a story, and it was a really hard film to do.
The Black Press never pretended to be objective because it didn't see the white press being objective, and it often took a position. It had an attitude. This was a press of advocacy. There was news, but the news had an admitted and a deliberate slant.
And then I love the film that we just completed on Emmett Till, The Murder of Emmett Till. It's just, it's a very moving film. And it's an emotional, it's a historic film, but it's an emotional film. And I think the way that few historical films are.
I saw a hole, which I presumed was a bullet hole. And I could look through that hole and see daylight on the other side. And I wondered, was it necessary to shoot it?
Here is Money, Mississippi, the home of Roy Bryant. It was here that the Chicago Negro boy, Emmett Till, is alleged to have paid unwelcome attention to Roy Bryant's most attractive wife.
When white women was on the streets, you had to get off the street. That was a way of life.
Well, I thought Emmett Till's story was important because, you know, as a young person, it was something that moved me and moved a generation of people. And I thought that for so many people, the story was about to really get lost. And that we're coming in that strange period where the people involved in the story were very old. And if we didn't tell it now, we wouldn't be able to tell it, at least in the same way. But there's also a subtext to the whole Emmett Till story into the civil rights movement, and that is that if you think that we need change in this country and change in the world, then you've got to go out and change things. And I think that that's kind of this kind of subtext that we want to get across in the film. I was actually in Mississippi filming The Murder of Emmett Till, and my cell phone rang, and it was the president of the MacArthur Foundation who told me I had won this MacArthur Fellows Award, you know, the so-called Genius Award. I was just shocked. It came out of nowhere, completely out of nowhere. And, you know, it was just incredible, an incredible experience. I think I'm the 11th filmmaker in the history of the program, and the program's been going on over 20 years. So. It's really hard to say how any award, you know, any, you know, prize at a film festival or any of that really helps. I mean, it's not concrete. It's not like somebody says, okay, I'm going to now give you a grant to do this film because you got a MacArthur, you know. But every little thing that every little bit of recognition that you get, I think, helps you get up one more step, you know, up that staircase, and maybe makes it just a little bit easier. But it's still not easy. For young filmmakers, I say that, you know, you have to understand that it's going to be a struggle, you know. And if you're a documentary filmmaker, it's probably going to always be a struggle. But you have to love the struggle. I mean, you have to love making films. You know, I go to a lot of film festivals, and, you know, with my films and see a lot of films. And so many times the problem is that the films have nothing to say. You know, people, I mean, they look good. You know, they look like a real film, you know, but there's nothing to be said. You know, there's nothing that's being said there, and I think that's something that you really have to think about, is what do you want to say with the film? My real dream is that people would be moved to some kind of action, you know, by my films. But, you know, films are really hard, you know. I mean, one thing I realized when I started making films, I tried to think of a film that had changed my life. I realized that there were none. You know, I mean, I don't know if films really do that. I think it can be part of a process. You know, I'm not trying to make the film that's going to shake the world up and change the world. But if I can just, you know, like help an ongoing process a little bit, then I think I've done my job.
Even though your cost to attend CUNY is low, The university still offers a full range of financial aid opportunities. Over 70% of CUNY's full-time undergraduate students receive some sort of financial aid. For information on financial aid, call 1-800-CUNY-YES or visit our website at cuny.edu. College is aimed at attracting outstanding high school seniors to CUNY colleges. The program offers financial and other incentives to students with top grades and SAT scores. One of the perks is a passport that gives Honors College students access to art exhibits, museums, and cultural events. This year, students develop their own creative projects based on those cultural experiences, and CUNY held its own event to showcase their work.
It's a very exciting evening. We have 17 groups, 68 teams who were sent to 17 different exhibits and performances all over the city. What we hope to do here, we hope to get students interested in the arts, knowledgeable about the arts, and also we hope to make them feel like they're part of the arts of this city. And tonight, several groups will be actually performing on stage based on some of the performances they saw. They've created their own skits. They've created their own iMovies. They've created their own PowerPoints to talk about the arts. And I think that shows how much excitement and energy there is around this program. So we're thrilled.
As a major in biochemistry, I will minor in theater. I loved the experience. It was very entertaining. It was very fun.
We interviewed Peter Hansen. He was the production stage manager of Cabaret. And through the right people, we were able to interview him at Studio 54 through the Honors College connections.
Exposed, the Victorian nude. They just put it so blatantly, like, exposed. When you first see the sign, you get the impression like, wait, there's something that they're trying to hide here, and it's out in the open. It's like, boom, exposed in that sense way. It's trying to reveal something in a sense. And that's the impression that I was under too. But once you go into the exhibit, it's not as controversial as what people might have perceived. For me personally, it's a totally different experience because I've come from a conservative family, being a Muslim, where women are in a society where it's totally like different to this. This experience for myself was something like, okay, you know, I'm just gonna learn this, and I was shocked. I had a great time enjoying it.
I'm gonna be performing our interpretation of Cabaret. It's gonna be a mix of stage presentation and PowerPoint presentation. Well, definitely they've opened our eyes because they've allowed us to, you know, view different kinds of presentations. We go to Broadway plays, we've went to the opera, we've been to all these different kind of things. And I never get to go to one on my own because, you know, something's expensive or it's out of the way. And, you know, just being in the city on a daily basis is an experience itself. So that's what I like about it.
If you are a student who loves to learn and loves to meet other people, and loves and thinks that you would like learning more about the city, the courses that we offer in the Honors College all focus on New York. We hope that the people who come to the Honors College will become the leaders in business, in public life, in the arts, in every realm of endeavor in New York.
Still up on Study with the Best, a Brooklyn College graduate with a passion for parks.
And from city high schools to the city council, so stay tuned.
But first, this message from the Chancellor.
Hi, I'm Matthew Goldstein, Chancellor of the City University of New York. I want to thank the alumni of our 20 colleges for all that you have accomplished and represent. You are the American dream come true. Most of you, over 80%, remain in New York 10 years after graduation. You provide the tax base of our city and state. You give back in taxes many times more dollars than our society invested in you. You have become Nobel laureates, members of Congress, mayors, corporate executives, world-class actors, and even a Supreme Court justice and a Secretary of State. You are the teachers, doctors, nurses, lawyers, social workers, and accountants that make our city and state work. Whatever challenges lie ahead, you bring with you all of the skills you learned at CUNY. We are very proud of all that you have accomplished and all that you will achieve. Thank you.
You probably know Sam Schwartz as Gridlock Sam, who writes a column about traffic in the New York Daily News. But what you probably don't know is that the Brooklyn College graduate was a traffic commissioner and is a civil engineer who's helped make a number of New York parks more bicycle and pedestrian friendly. More recently, Schwartz has been on a mission to restore one of Lower Manhattan's historic parks to its original splendor.
Gridlock Sam is me, but also a character that my brother Brian, Dr. Brian Schwartz, who's also at CUNY, created about a dozen years ago. Felt that I was often predicting traffic, and we ought to create a character like the weatherman for traffic. And so out of that was born Gridlock Sam. I write a column for the New York Daily News every day, and I predict tomorrow's traffic. 22 years ago, I coined the term gridlock during the transit strike of 1980, and it became a popular word ever since. It was in the 70s that we were working on the grid system of Manhattan, and we knew that we had to get the mayor's attention to get him to think that solving the problem during the transit strike was more than just sending out 10,000 cops to intersections, that there really was a science of traffic. And we had to get him and others afraid that something dire would happen, but how do you describe it? A big traffic jam, a really big traffic jam? So we said gridlock would occur, and that's where the word really came from. Now all the dictionaries have gridlock. Some of them have the history of gridlock. My passion is really for cities and making cities better. And transportation is a pretty good way of doing that. As a junior traffic engineer, I was living near Prospect Park, Brooklyn, and the plans for Prospect Park or the roadways, the entrance roadways at Ocean Avenue came by my desk. And I was looking at them, and I loved the park. I'm a big fan of Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvert Volks, and they designed this wonderful park that I was enjoying 100 years later. And I look at roads there and I say, well, here I have the plans in front of me. If I just draw some red lines over here, these roads will disappear. And it came through my desk. I drew the lines and gave it back to my supervisor, who then sent it out to the contractor. Roads disappeared in the park. Trees began to grow where there was asphalt. And it was just magical. In fact, on Canal Street, this was an amazing story. About 2 years ago, a community group came to see me. The state was building the West Side Highway. They had plans for a huge interchange, 14 lanes at Canal Street in every which direction. The Tribeca community said that this is going to cause a lot of problems with their neighborhood. They'd be overwhelmed with traffic. It would be harder for pedestrians to get across. And they said, would I help out? We discovered, working with the community, that Canal Street at the West Side Highway had been a park from 1870 to 1930. A Calvert Volks designed park of Olmsted and Volks fame. And in 1930, when they put up the Miller Highway, then it became known as the West Side Highway, they destroyed the park. So we looked at that and said, maybe we could bring back this park that had been gone for 70 years. And we came up with a new traffic solution. And later, within a year, a Calvert Volks park, exactly the way Calvert Volks designed, in fact, with a serpentine path going through it, which is characteristic of his designs, and the period fences from the 1860s and 1870s will be back on Canal Street, and we made the park even larger. So one of the things that I'm able to do is, I come from the background of being the engineer in the equation with the planners and the architects, and they're all startled when they meet an engineer that says, you could close off that lane. Yeah, we can do some nice treatment and plant some trees along here. We can make it easier for pedestrians to get across and creatively still manage the traffic as well or better.
CUNY offers a range of educational options, whether you're interested in a senior college or a community college, a certificate program, or a graduate degree. You should contact CUNY's Office of Admission Services at 1-800-CUNY-YES or visit our website, cuny.edu. College Now is a partnership between CUNY and the city school system that started more than 20 years ago. It introduces high school students to college classes and culture. College Now also offers a number of special programs, like the Model City Council Project, where participants learn firsthand about the governing body and the job of a city council member. Advanced courses and extracurricular activities are instrumental in helping high school seniors prepare for College Now.
My name is Everett Borgia, and I'm a student of John Vann High School. I take a College Now course at Queens College.
My name is Eddie Going, and I'm 17 years old, and I attend Newdorp High School in Staten Island, New York. I'm a member of the Kingsborough Community College Student Advisory Board and their College Now program, which is through my high school, which allows high school seniors to obtain college credit while still attending high school.
It was a four-week training session. We were divided as boroughs, and we would go into our groups, discuss term limits. It's where you restrict a politician's tenure in office. Term limits are of different types, actually. You can have a lifetime term limit that's once your time in office is over, you can come back to it. But there are also term limits that you can fulfill 8 years and then take a break and then come back to office. Term limits serve the same purpose. They restrict power, and well, in a way, I think it restricts democracy, but that's my view. The third week was actually where the action started, and they gave us the bill, and there was a lot of controversy on, you know, how you should bring the bill about, and, you know, should we even have the bill. And the last week was, I think, one of the most exciting weeks that, you know, has ever been in the Model New York City Council, because that's the time when you pull all the people that you can to your side and you say, well, you know, you can get this if you support me. It's an amazing experience that, you know, you have to convince people to come to your side.
through the New York City Model Council, I guess we didn't realize until maybe today that it was the first time that they were actually doing something like this, but that it was going to affect our lives significantly and leave us with so much knowledge.
Making a decision that will affect many people.
Term limits are vital to the future of this great city.
This is a false claim.
Term limits do not guarantee improvement in government.
What you saw today was all the whole debate. I mean, we were just prepared to vote on the bills, but a lot of talent come up there and give a lot of speeches, and it was very impressive. My whole attention was the ceremonial, because I was the one who was supposed to host the ceremonial, and that was my part in the Model New York City Council.
I would ask the Honorable A. Gifford Miller to join me at the dais.
It's a pleasure to welcome all of you here, Madam Speaker and members of the Council.
What an extraordinary event. What an extraordinary experience for these young people to be involved in a hands-on way, to be able to see government up front and personal, to be in City Hall, this beautiful, beautiful building, to be in the City Council room, to have had the experience, the training that it took to get to this place. It's a life-changing event.
Well, personally, I've never been really interested in politics until now, and a few short months ago when we were actually introduced to this, I guess that would be something that definitely changed my life.
I should say I've changed a lot, because when I was in India, I used to be a very shy kid, and I was never used to so much attention. I used to hate stages. I hated dioceses, and I dreaded going up there, and I never would ever do something like that. But I think my school and Model New York City has like changed me, and in a way it's made me a more confident person.
I saw what an experience like this can do to give new ideas and new encouragement to young people.
We're walking away, I guess, today, each and every one of us, with our citation and the knowledge of these past few weeks and meeting and socializing with everybody at each meeting, that we really, in a small way, we played a major part in contributing to our government.
Well, that's a wrap. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week. In the meantime, remember to study.
Study with the best.